from realizing the truth about orbits to understanding the size of the moon and more. Join me as I reveal to you amazing astronomical discoveries from ancient Greece. You might think it's odd that we're focusing solely on a certain culture in regards to ancient astronomy, because, as we all know, there were many nations that went and did various forms of astronomy themselves, including the Babylonians, the Chinese, and more. But the Greeks were the ones who helped figure out certain things over time and put certain standards in place that would allow us to be where we are today. For example, the name planet comes from the Greek term planētēs, meaning wanderer. As ancient astronomers noted how certain lights moved across the sky in relation to the other stars. Five extraterrestrial planets can be seen with the naked eye: Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. The Greek names being Hermes, Aphrodite, and Cronus. Sometimes the luminaries, the sun and the moon, are added to the list of naked eye planets to make a total of seven. Since the planets disappear from time to time when they approach the sun, careful attention is required to identify all five. Observations of Venus are not straightforward. Early Greeks thought that the evening and morning appearances of Venus represented two different objects, calling it Hesperus, evening star, when it appeared in the western evening sky, and Phosphorus, lightbringer, when it appeared in the eastern morning sky. They eventually came to recognize that both objects were the same planet. Pythagoras is given credit for this realization. In classical Greece, astronomy was a branch of mathematics. Astronomers sought to create geometrical models that could imitate the appearance of celestial motions. This tradition began with the Pythagoreans, who placed astronomy among the four mathematical arts, along with arithmetic, geometry, and music. The study of these four arts was taken upon by many, including Plato, who used it as part of his own philosophical teachings, and even advised some of his students to do the same. According to a story reported by Simplicius of Cilicia, 6th century, Plato posed a question for the Greek mathematicians of his day. By assumption of what uniform and orderly motions can the apparent motions of the planets be accounted for? Quoted in Lloyd, 1970, page 84. Plato proposed that the seemingly chaotic wandering motions of the planets could be explained by combinations of uniform circular motions centered on a spherical Earth. Apparently a novel idea in the 4th century. The problem, though, was that many of their ideas and notions about how the solar system worked as a whole was still flawed. One of which was the Eudoxian system, which was considered great by some, but not by others, because it was flawed in terms of being accurate. In the 2nd century BC, Hipparchus, aware of the extraordinary accuracy with which Babylonian astronomers could predict the planet's motions, insisted that Greek astronomers achieve similar levels of accuracy. Somehow he had access to Babylonian observations or predictions and used them to create better geometrical models. For the sun, he used a simple eccentric model based on observations of the equinoxes, which explained both changes in the speed of the sun and differences in the lengths of the seasons. For the moon, he used a deferent and epicycle model. He could not create accurate models for the remaining planets, and criticized other Greek astronomers for creating inaccurate models. Hipparchus also compiled a star catalog. According to Pliny the Elder, he observed a nova, new star, so that later generations could tell whether other stars came to be, perished, moved, or changed in brightness. He recorded the position and brightness of the stars. Ptolemy mentioned the catalog in connection with Hipparchus's discovery of precession. Precession of the equinoxes is a slow motion of the place of the equinoxes through the zodiac, caused by the shifting of Earth's axis. Hipparchus thought it was caused by the motion of the sphere of fixed stars. Still though, their thoughts on the solar system at large were wrong, and for a very basic reason. They didn't really understand what was at the center of the solar system. In the 3rd century BC, Aristarchus of Samos proposed an alternate cosmology, arrangement of the universe, a heliocentric model of the solar system, placing the sun, not the Earth, at the center of the known universe. Hence, he is sometimes known as the Greek Copernicus. His astronomical ideas were not well received, however, and only a few brief references to them are preserved. We know the name of one follower of Aristarchus, Seleucus of Seleucia. Aristarchus also wrote a book on the sizes and distances of the Sun and Moon, which is his only work to have survived. In this work, he calculated the sizes of the Sun and the Moon, as well as their distances from the Earth in Earth radii. Shortly afterwards, Eratosthenes calculated the size of the Earth, providing a value for the Earth radii which could be plugged into Aristarchus' calculations. Hipparchus wrote another book on the sizes and distances of the Sun and the Moon, which has not survived. Both Aristarchus and Hipparchus drastically underestimated the distance of the Sun from the Earth. Nevertheless, it is a jaw-dropping finding, especially when you consider that it wasn't rediscovered until the 16th century by Nicholas Copernicus, who even acknowledged Aristarchus during the development of his own work. Think about that. We could have had a much greater understanding of the universe if the ancient Greeks believed in Aristarchus and his findings. But not unlike many events that would happen between and after the time of Copernicus, anyone who didn't have a certain viewpoint of the universe, meaning that it was the center of the universe and that it was the plan of the gods to make it that way, were put on blast because it didn't conform to the larger will and beliefs of the Greeks. The irony of this is rich, obviously. Before we continue to showcase the history of Greece in astronomy, be sure to like or dislike the video. That way we can continue to improve our content for you, the viewer. Also be sure to subscribe so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. So eventually they realized that the Sun was the center of the solar system. But what else did they figure out? Well, remember what I said about the two astronomers, Aristarchus and Seleucus, trying to figure out the size of the Sun and Moon? Well, it's a lot more complicated in figuring that out than you might think. At the instance when the Moon is at first or third quarter, Aristarchus reasoned that the Sun, Earth, and Moon would form a right angle triangle. As Pythagoras had determined how the length of triangle sides were related a couple of centuries earlier, Aristarchus used the triangle to estimate that the distance to the Sun was between 18 and 20 times the distance to the Moon. He also estimated that the size of the Moon was approximately one-third that of Earth, based on careful timing of lunar eclipses. Obviously, he was wrong about the Sun, as we noted earlier, but the Moon bit wasn't too far off. To be technical, the size of the Moon compared to the Earth is just over a fourth, or 0.27 the size of Earth. But given that's only about 0.06 off from what he noted, that's still a pretty accurate guess given all that he had to work with. This is one of the reasons why it's so incredible that astronomers like Aristarchus was able to do at least somewhat accurate interpretations of the solar system and the universe as a whole in some cases hundreds of years before anything should have been noted accurately. And yet they did it. And while not everything was right, a lot of things hit the nail on the head, or was pretty close. Much of what the Greeks did set a tone or a standard, or learned to be a standard, so that others could take up what they learned and adjust and get better and more. And that wasn't the only thing that the Greeks basically got right. They also made some correct predictions about the Earth itself, which was pretty spectacular at the time of its learning. Eratosthenes, 276 BC to 195 BC, was chief librarian at the Great Library of Alexandria and a keen experimentalist. Among his many achievements was the earliest known calculation of the circumference of the Earth, which you might not think of as something that would be Earth-shattering, if you will, but in fact it was a key thing to determine. Pythagoras is generally regarded as the earliest proponent of a spherical Earth, although apparently not its size. Eratosthenes' famous and yet simple method relied on measuring the different lengths of shadows cast by poles stuck vertically into the ground at midday on the summer solstice at different latitudes. The Sun is sufficiently far away that wherever its rays arrive at Earth, they are effectively parallel, as had previously been shown by Aristarchus. So the difference in the shadows demonstrated how much the Earth's surface curved. Eratosthenes used this to estimate the Earth's circumference as approximately 40,000 kilometers. This is within a couple of percent of the actual value, as established by modern geodesy, the science of the Earth's shape. Later, another scientist called Posidonius, 135 BC to 251 BC, used a slightly different method and arrived at almost exactly the same answer. Posidonius lived on the island of Rhodes for much of his life. There he observed the bright star Canopus, which would lie very close to the horizon. However, when in Alexandria, in Egypt, he noted Caponus would ascend to some 7.5 degrees above the horizon. Given that 7.5 degrees is 1/48th of a circle, He multiplied the distance from Rhodes to Alexandria by 48 and arrived at a value also of approximately 40,000 kilometers. Do you want to know the exact circumference of the Earth? That would be 40,075 kilometers. Yep, they were just 75 kilometers off the exact size, and they did this long before it should have been done. All they did was use basic science and the various tools and math that they had available to them, and they made it work. Just goes to show you that sometimes the most complicated of things can be figured out using the basics. Of course, the Greeks weren't above making complicated things as well. Let me ask you a question. Do you know what the Antikythera Mechanism is? The amazing device was discovered in an ancient shipwreck off the Greek island of Antikythera in 1900, and it is in fact the world's oldest mechanical calculator. If you were to look at it now, you wouldn't be impressed by it. That's what happens when you're underwater for many, many years. But once upon a time, it would have been the most advanced and complicated devices in all the world. And it had a very special function, to help people understand where everything was in the sky based on the date. When manually rotated by a handle, the gears span dials on the exterior showing the phases of the moon, the timing of lunar eclipses, and the positions of the five planets then known, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, at different times of the year. This even accounted for their retrograde motion, an illusionary change in the movement of planets through the sky. Think about that for a moment. Think about how one had to know an extreme amount of things about the solar system and how everything worked to get this device to happen. Then I want you to think about how it was very likely this device was made all the way back in the 3rd or 1st centuries BC. Exactly, someone made this thousands of years before they reasonably should have. Examiners of the device noted that something of this caliber, of this machination, was not found for another thousand years. So for the Greeks to make it and be accurate about it, that was quite a feat of engineering. Though no fully intact Antikythera mechanism has been found, that doesn't mean we can't learn from it, and many are studying to try and figure out more about how it worked, as well as any clues as to who made it. The prevailing theory is Archimedes, but that's just a theory. It also should be noted that aside from the discoveries that we listed here, that Greek astronomy had a major impact on other parts of the world, including helping inspire the people of India to take it up themselves and learn from their models. And it's more than fair to say that the full extent of the reach and understanding of the Greeks and their dives into astronomy will never be known, mainly because many texts and books, some outlined earlier, have been lost to time or were destroyed because of their contents and views. But that's not to say that their impact isn't felt to this day. In fact, for many centuries and millennia to come, the Greeks' influence on astronomy is felt, from the naming of planets and stars after their pantheons to the constellations having various connects to the Greek mythology and more. Today, astronomy and the exploration of space is one of the most important things in the world, including the act of trying to get us onto other planets. But imagine how far behind we would be if the ancient cultures like Greece didn't go and start everything off all those centuries ago. Thanks for watching, everyone. What did you think of this look at Greek astronomy and how they helped discover or understand various parts of the solar system? Which of these discoveries were you most surprised about in terms of their finding? Can you believe how good or accurate the Greeks were in some of their analysis? Let us know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.